together. Seen you in traffic in town, which has occurred a time or two, but I welcome each and every one of you, and a face or two that I don't even have a name for, and that's always a good thing, but we certainly do welcome you here in our midst. And for those who are connecting, joining us Facebook Live, we certainly welcome you too. Let's invite God to come now. Only God, Lord, as we come to worship, to praise you, Lord, we invite you. Come now into this place and pour your Holy Spirit out on each and every one of us, Lord. Lead and guide us with your wisdom as we comfort now in the warmth of your love. Amen and amen. Amen.
say to you that makes you happy? Think about it. What can I tell you? Anything? So you're telling me it's a done deal. Y'all just going to look at me like that, right?
No, they're already happy.
They're already happy.
But they're pretending not to.
Is that it?
Yeah.
If I told you that when you die, you get to go and live again forever,
woo,
would it make you happy? Some of you. Some of you are not real sure.
Maybe they're on the road to hell.
Well, hey, there you go. But now let me tell you what. Some of you, if this is your happy look, you need help. All right? I want you to put your happy on today.
Yeah. Prove me wrong.
When we sing some glad morning, when this life is old, or I'll fly away if I have to. All right. I want you to get your hands out. Dan, out of pocket. There you go. Okay, now, you know how this goes. I even had a shocking event this morning. I asked Tyler. I said, Tyler, when I get one spot in this song, I said, I may call you up. I want you to come up and clog for me. You know what Tyler said? What is clogging?
That's when the drain don't run, right? Yeah,
that's what he said. All right, let's try this again. Now put your hands together and make a little noise with me. Let's try and be happy, or at least act like it, okay?
All right. That's kind of where we are now as far as getting advertisements and stuff out. But some stuff is happening, and you may have read in there this week that we have planned to return to worship May the 2nd, and that's still true. And you may also have read in there that our projected worship times will be 8:30 and 10:30. That's questionable, okay? So we finally have had some people, we ask, and nobody spoke up until we projected what we thought we wanted to do. But now we're looking at some of that, and we'll announce to you. You got plenty of time, okay? It's going to only be like a 30-minute shift or something, one way or the other, or maybe each way. So hang on. We want to do what's kind of, I'm a utilitarian. That means the greatest good for the greatest number. So we are looking at that. Moving forward. But May the 2nd is the day. You know that that's the day before one of the biggest Sundays in the entire church year, right? The next Sunday is what day? Mother's Day, that's one of the big three. Easter, Christmas, and Mother's Day. That's the three big Sundays in the church. So that's kind of intentional what we're doing, believe it or not. We've put some thought into it. Now we've got some more people joining us and helping to make these decisions. So we want the best for everybody involved. The Sunday evening youth meets 5 to 7. Wednesday evening, we have not only the youth meeting from 6 to 8, but also our faith kids, our children, are meeting, and we have a parents class as well that meets on Wednesday evening from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock. So that's up to you. Very small groups now. The Joy Club, United Methodist Women, Men's Fellowship, various have already met. So if you're part and you're ready to get together and to meet, by all means, you know, we can make a place available and you find the time that will work for you. And I know we're not out of pandemic. I know that very well. But we've got some upcoming things going. And I think as soon as we get through some of this spring break and such and so forth, that it's going to get even better than it is now. That's being optimistic. But hopefully we can get through that. That week of spring break, there will be no Wednesday study groups at all. That 31st of March, because everybody's going to be spring breaking, and we won't be here that Wednesday night. So continue to pray and to pray us forward as we move into to these things that you know we can remain safe. I know there's going to be some risk involved, but hopefully there'll be less and less risk as we move into these things. In the way of prayer concerns, Ms. Joyce Davis had a surgery this past week, and she is recuperating from that. And also, we had a birth in the church, and you're saying, who was pregnant, right? But you may, by the time the pandemic hit and such and all, but Sean and Jessica Metcalf has a son. Now, you may have seen it in the Midweek Light, but his name is Sean Jameson Metcalf. And they're going to call him SJ. So I think he was 7'11 or something, and that was big enough to be a keeper, right? And I don't think you can put them back anyhow. You know, you got to take them whatever size they were. But anyhow, everything, as far as I know, everything is going very, very well with that. So we always celebrate new life and birth and all. A continued prayer for Timmy Dodson, Charlie Bernard, Robin Klinger, had a celebration of praise for Robert Cosson, and Mike Carpenter is in a rehab center. Mary Kay Sisk remains weak, and Miss Frances Boyd, and I don't see her. I know she's come a time or two, but she has a large transition in her life. She is moving here in a few weeks, so we lift her up. And Simone Kilpatrick, a lady from Wood Station, had a recent surgery. And I know there's others as well, and some of us continue to struggle with various different things in our life. So as we go now into a time of prayer, let's pray together first in silence. Humbly and earnestly, awesome God, we seek you in all we say and all we do. And Lord, we come saying thanks. Thanks for life, and thanks for life so abundant. Lord, we come praising you for new life. And we just pray that you be with Sean and Jessica and little SJ, and especially Riley Rose, the big sister. God, we just lift them up to you now as they accept this change into the house. And God, we know that it's exciting and exhausting at the same time, Lord. But we praise you for the new life. And Lord, we continue to lift up to you those that we've named, those who are now in a time of rehabilitation from recent surgeries, and those, Lord, who continue to struggle with recuperation from the virus. God, we know that this struggle is not only real, but it's extremely different from one person to another. And whatever symptoms they may or may not have had, and the time of getting over it and recuperating, God, we just thank you, Lord, for always being there with us. Lord, we lack your tender touch. We need your healing hand. God, continue to be with those who struggle. Some, Lord, we know that this time of year gets very difficult. But as we see things turning green and beginning to bloom and blossom, and Lord, we know that it's an opportunity to get a fresh start, to get going again. And God, we just praise you. We praise you, Lord, for your presence and spirit in our lives, Lord. And we ask you to continue to encourage each and every one of us with your peace, God, as we pause. Now, Lord, we know that you continue to love us and to forgive us. And God, although our intentions remain somewhat greater than our accomplishments, again and again, we know that you're always there. Wrap your everlasting arms around us and give us the blessed assurance of knowing that we are truly all your children. God, as we continue to worship together, Lord, let us unite our voices, praying aloud the very prayer that Jesus taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I want you to join me. To some of you, it'll be a new song. Some of you probably know it. But I love it when there's comparisons. And this song says we are like new wine. You know, it all comes forth from the crushing of the grapes to the fermenting, to the straining, which is what God has to do with us sometimes. Strain out the bad and leave the good and make that new wine. Fresh and new. I tell you what, I'm just going to let you sit, okay? If you know it, sing with us. You'll know it if there's a repeat in it, okay? Thank you.
Praise God. You may be seated. Children, if you want to come up and join me. And I saw Miss Zoe go. There she is. I thought I saw you go out with someone a while ago. But Miss Zoe's going to come up and share with us a few minutes. And Thomas. Oh, it's great to see you.
Okay, so who knows what these are? I told you just a minute ago.
I believe they know.
They do know. By its shape. What do magnets do? Do you know, Connor? Why we brought magnets today?
It's kind of like how we go to God and Jesus.
That's a very good guess, Connor. You're right. So the magnets, they signify God's love for us. Because everybody knows sometimes we make some choices that aren't the best choices, right? Because that's just natural. That happens to everybody. But these magnets are like God's love for us. No matter what we do, just like these magnets, God's love will always pull us back into Him. Did you know that? Did you know that? Yeah?
Yes. No.
You didn't know that? Well, now you do, right? Okay. Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. So let's say a quick prayer, and then we'll head over to Children's Church, okay? Greg Tack, would you like to pray for us?
Yes. God, we do thank you for your love that continues to draw all of us, not only to you, but ultimately closer and closer to each other because you've adopted us all with your love to be your children. God, we thank you most of all for your love and your saving grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Ms. Zoe, and good to have you back doing our children's moment for us. She's been in the nursery for several weeks, and thank you for those of you that have signed up for the nursery. We're kind of in a dilemma, and I realize we can't hire anybody for 1 hour a week. You know, it's just not. So we've been asking for volunteers to help with the nursery. We have a sign-in on this board over here, and I've set it up to where you sign up for one time only, okay? I know most of the things around the church, and some of you are going to amen this, when you sign up, it's like a life sentence. Amen. This, you can sign up for one time only. Not you, Dick. Yours is a life sentence. From John in the 12th chapter, and you may recognize this text for the simple reason that quite often we use this in the celebration of life. It's just appropriate to use then. We'll explain that a little more But I've gone to Peterson's paraphrase called The Message because I just like the way that he words this. And I encourage you, it's easy to do with the YouVersion electronic on our smartphones or devices that we can switch from one version to another. But I think he says, listen carefully. Unless a grain of wheat is buried in the ground, dead to the world, it is never any more than a grain of wheat. But when it is buried, it sprouts and reproduces itself many times over. In the same way, anyone who holds on to life just as it is destroys that life. But when you let it go, reckless in your love, you'll have it forever, real and eternal. When any of you wants to serve me, then follow me. Then you'll be where I am, ready to serve at a moment's notice. The Father will honor and reward anyone who serves me. Right now I am storm-tossed, and what I am going to say, Father, get me out of this. No, this is why I came in the first place. I'll say, Father, put your glory on display. A voice came out of the sky. I have glorified it, and I'll glorify it again. The listening crowd said, thunder. Others said, an angel spoke to him. And Jesus said, the voice didn't come for me, but for you. At this moment, the world is in crisis. Now, Satan, the ruler of this world, will be thrown out. And I, as I am lifted up from the earth, will attract everyone to me and gather them around me. He put this way to show how he was going to be put to death. May God add for us now, not only the reading and the hearing, but also some understanding of this. It's the Holy Scriptures. It's the Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way, for you are the potter, and I am the clay. Amen. Understand, we're in Lent, and we're moving. We're moving each and every day in our own personal journeys. We're moving not to the cross, but through the cross. We're going to come out victorious on the other side. Trust me on this. I've already gone through Easter a few times, and I know most of you have as well. And I know for sure that most of you believe that what happened on that cross, but that's what he's talking about. Jesus is trying to share with those whom he's teaching, those disciples and others is gathered around him. So he goes to this, what I call agronology or pharmaceutics. It's literally a metaphoric language here that he's using to explain to them. And like many of you that I know for sure that you've planted a seed or two or maybe many, that you have some knowledge about a seed being planted. So Jesus then shares this fact that when a grain of wheat is planted, when it's planted, up until it's planted, it's just filled with the potential. And it's there. And it's just only a grain. But he says, when it's buried, or when it's planted in the earth. And well, scientifically, we know what happens in the germination process and so forth. But he goes on to say that this one single seed then can produce many seeds. And that's what he's trying to set up for them, because they must be questioning. That's an assumption. It doesn't tell us. They must be questioning him as to why. Why, if you're the Son of God, do you have to die? And he says in here that I've even asked, but I realize that's why I've come. And to die, to overcome sin and death. And then he asks for God to speak and to glorify this moment, and God speaks, and they think it's thunder or maybe an angel speaking. And he said, no. He spoke so that you, he did this for you. It's all for you. And in this text then, well, some of you, you don't have to raise your hand. You can if you want to. Some of you may remember when Betty Crocker came out with a cake mix. The very first cake mix Betty Crocker came out with would not sell. All you had to do was mix water. Just pour water and stir it up and put it in the pan. And some of you are thinking, why wasn't I around then? It wouldn't sell. You know why? Because cooks have to do more than just put water. You know, that's just simple to make a pancake, right? We're making a sure enough cake. So they came back and fixed the problem. So now you have to add an egg and water. Sure enough. And the truth is, to begin with, it was just absolutely too simple. Just too simple. So quite often people are faced with this dilemma of accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior of their life. And they say, what do I have to do? I said, just pray repentance. Just turn your life over to God. Just accept God and just ask God to forgive you of your sins and to help you each and every day, to encourage you forward in your life. And it's just that simple. And they're like, I don't even have to add an egg. It's just that simple. It really and truly is. And it seems like something this great and grandiose, this amazing grace thing, that there must be more to it than just accepting and transforming and changing my life. In the time of Lent, I keep going back to Joel in the second chapter, and he said, rend your heart. Rend your heart, not your clothes. The Old Testament had a thing of tearing your clothes to show that you were remorse, but he said, rend your heart. Literally, open yourself up to God. And it's just that simple. It really and truly is, and what we need to do is just that simple. In this illustration today, we understand how simple it is to plant a seed. You know, at a certain depth and a certain soil with some moisture and some sunshine and so forth, and the seed does the rest of the work. Right? The seed does the rest of the work. Right? God created that seed. God created grace for us. And in that, is that potential. That potential. And Jesus says, look, when that seed is planted, he's talking about himself, that when he is buried, and then from that will bear much fruit. And that's what he says, if you want, should you want to serve me, should you want to serve me, then you must be buried to the life. Literally, let go of what it is that you're doing and accept the life of God, the life of Christ, and let that work in and through you. And through that, then you will produce much fruit. Luckily for us, you know, we rarely ever see the effects of our good works. We rarely ever, and that's a good thing, because I think it would be pretty easy for some of us to get haughty. I mean, you know, really start getting big-headed and thinking, you know, well, I'm just, you know, we just need to be about whatever it is that God has called us to be about and let God do the work. You know, it's like a mom and dad, and we were talking about the new birth this week, Sean Jameson Metcalf, and some 9 months ago, you know, a seed was planted. And then through this time, it's called gestation. Through this gestation period, it grew and it grew and it grew. And who knows down the road? Only God knows down the road the potential of how many more Sean Metcalfs they might be. And we all understand and realize that the potential to produce and to reproduce, I understand a single grain of corn when everything is ideal situation, may produce as many as 600 more grains. That's a pretty good stalk of corn, probably with 3 ears on it, right? That's probably in a field that's going to add 200 bushels an acre. Any of you farmers understand what I'm talking about? Right. I know this. I really truly do. Sunnybrook Farms was pioneers in no-till farming. That means they didn't plow the ground. They figured out how to farm without plowing up the ground and letting the rains wash it away. Instead, they kept making it more fertile, more fertile, more fertile. And I know for a fact they were one of the first farms to ever grow 200 bushels to the acre corn, non-irrigated, because of the farming practices that they did. But they planned, and they planned, and they kept working on top of what they had already done and expanding and going further and further and further in their practices until they were able, not every year, that took an ideal rain, and everything had to be absolutely ideal in order for that to happen. But I'm talking about 3 big ears per stalk kind of corn. That's what God wants of us. He has that potential in each one of us. I know, I'm calling you seeds. Each one of us is a potential seed that in us has that ability with the Holy Spirit. See, that's where we kind of shy off sometimes when we get to thinking about the Holy Spirit and living and following literally in the Holy Spirit. But Jesus says, unless you're willing to die to yourself and follow me. And that's receiving and all the advocate. See, he knew, and he was trying to teach his disciples and those following that he was going to die. He said, unless I'm raised up from this world. What do you think that means? When he says, when I'm raised up from the earth, what do you really and truly think he's saying there? You know, ascending up to heaven, and he eventually does that. But you know what he's talking about? He's talking about the first 10 feet of the journey. That high. You want to be raised. You want to be raised into glory. You want to be raised into eternal life. You want to follow Christ. You have to be willing to go the first 10 feet. If you can make it the first 10 feet, hallelujah. Say it with me. Hallelujah. Amen. The first 10 feet is being able to go with him. He has come and he has died, knowing full well that he would produce more fruit. I called you seeds, only one seed. That's all we are. We're only one seed, but what potential do we have if we'll accept that first 10 feet? If we'll be willing to go that first 10 feet, and that means we're probably, maybe just so, we have to make a big transition or a change in our life. We might have to walk away from any and everything we know, depending on what God calls you to do. And sometimes even understanding that becomes somewhat difficult. You know, I grew up where we gardened. Dad loved to garden. And also, he had a tomato. I called it a sand hill. He called it a sand hill tomato. Some folks might would call it a German pink or something. But my dad thought when he sliced a slice of tomato and put it on a sandwich, I'm talking about, you know, old-fashioned Maria's bread with some Duke's mayonnaise on there, okay? And when he laid that slice of tomato on there, you know what? It should hang out all four sides of the bread. That's a slice of tomato. And he could grow those. And he could grow them, and he could have some of the first ripe tomatoes every year. He had perfected, at Valentine's Day every year, those seed that had been saved out of that first ripe tomato from the year before. Those seeds were saved, and they were taken care of. And then, the next year, he planted those seeds to make his plants for his tomatoes. And believe it or not, back in the 60s, I remember us taking tomatoes to the corner curb market. Yeah, some of y'all know what that means. We call them convenience stores now. But took them there and sold them for 99 cents a pound. You're thinking, well, that's kind of a bargain. No, that was a lot of money. A lot of people didn't make 60 bucks a week, but they'd pay a dollar for a tomato that weighed a pound. But he believed the potential was in the seed of that tomato that came off the vine, the first one to ripen. That was his theory. Was it true or not true? I guess some scientists might be able to disclaim it. But he believed that. He believed that seed had that potential in it. So that first ripe tomato, well, we did get to eat it after Granny had cleaned all the seeds out for him and saved them for the next year. All of us, only a seed. I mean, think of yourself. I'm only a seed. I'm only one single seed. But when I'm willing to go that first 10 feet, when I'm willing to accept what it is that God wants from me and to go forth with that, then the potential I have to produce the fruit that he needs me to produce. Look, folks, some of you remember the name Gracie Allen? It was said that she had, that's right, George Byrne. It was said that she called a repairman to come to her house because her clock was not working. And he came over and he said, well, ma'am, this is going to be an easy fix. He said, it's unplugged. He said, you know, if you'll just plug it up. She said, well, I only plug it up when I want to know what time it is. Some of us are guilty. We only want to be plugged up when we want to be God's servants. We only want to be plugged in when things are getting us down. And at that point in time, we decide, I think I'll go to church this Sunday. I feel like I need to get plugged in. I think I need to go in and praise God and worship a little bit and get back on my spiritual high. That's not anywhere close to what God expects of us. We don't know. Luckily, we don't know who's watching. We don't know who may be thinking about making some kind of decision to follow God and to give their life to Christ because they have seen the absolute example that we live each and every day. I know I run my mouth a lot preaching, but the best sermon ever preached don't need words. It's the one we live. It's the one we live. It's not the one that you hear. It's the one that you witness. And that's who we are. We're just seeds. We're just seeds. It was Niebuhr who wrote about being raised with Christ, that if we're going to make that journey, the first 10 feet is the hardest. And it's letting go. It's letting go of anything that might be preventing us from being the seed that God has created us to be. Hopefully, all of us have already let go. Hopefully, all of us have already decided, I can make it 10 feet. I can make it 10 feet. It's just that simple. God will add the Holy Spirit. Jesus told him, I'll send the Advocate. Paraclete, the companion to be with you. Pray with me. God, we open our hearts and minds now, Lord. We're ready. We come here, Lord, today, ready to receive you in yet a new way for a fresh start, God, that you can pour your Holy Spirit into each of us, Lord, as we open our hearts and minds. God, as we tear open and tear away from anything that might be preventing us to fully be able to produce fruit for you, not for ourselves. In the name of God, the Father, Jesus, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen and amen. As always, as we stand now to sing our closing hymn, the altar's open here for each and every one of you. If you want to come and praise God, if you want to dance in your place wherever you are, if you're watching us today on Facebook and you don't have a full commitment to God, if you just are pondering what I've been talking about today, 706-224-0775. Give me a call. Give me a call. Text me. I'll call you back. You know, if it's not a convenient time now, but I'd love to talk to you. It's just that simple. Let us stand as we sing. Size head you got, it fits because it's for you. You're that unique, and God loves you that much, and you're only one seed. Go now with the confidence filled with the love and the Spirit of God. Look to the light of God's love and reflect it into the world. where you live each and